It's time to induct our honorees. We're going to start up. Well, a little round of applause. All right. I will call a committee member up, and they will introduce our Hall of Fame honoree. And then the honoree will have a few minutes to give their speech, and then we'll have a nice picture as we present them with their plaque. And then we'll move on to the next inductee. At this time, I'd like to call up Ms. Karen Middleman, who will introduce our first inductee tonight. Karen, take it away.
Welcome. It gives me great pleasure to introduce posthumously Terry Buono into the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame. Terry graduated from Cranford in 1974, and then Glassboro State, which is now Rowan, in 1978. For those of you who are without gray hair, you may remember that in 1973 was when Title IX came into play. So for those of us who graduated before then, there was no New Jersey conference. We played Westfield in our gym uniforms. So Terry was on the freshman field hockey team in 71, freshman and JV basketball 71-72, and varsity softball, and was a captain from 72 to 74, and was the captain in 74. She went on to play varsity softball at Glassboro State from 75 to 78. But what Terry is known for is for her phenomenal coaching of the women's softball teams at Cranford High School. So she was conference champion for 10 years, 93 to 97, 99, 2000, 2002 to 2004, Union County champions in 2002, and she coached the team to the New Jersey sectional champions 97, 99, and 2000. And what I remember is I had two stepdaughters who were playing at Ridge and at Bernardsville, and when they went to play Cranford, they knew of the coach at Cranford High School. So I'm going to ask Keith Handler to come up and accept the award for Terry, the plaque.
Good evening. I just wanted to say on behalf of Mitch Buono and Terry, thank you to the committee and everybody that's here tonight. It's a great event, and we greatly appreciate the family and the friends. Thank you.
All right. Our next committee member, Mr. Bill Martin, will introduce our next inductee. Bill Martin.
Thank you. Candace Borges Hudeman is a tennis player extraordinaire. She graduated from Cranford in 1965 and then from James Madison University in 1969. In tennis at Cranford High School, she was number one in singles and doubles in the original Cranford High School team formed in 1964. At James Madison College University, she was number one in singles in 1965 and 1966. Here in Union County, this young girl won 17 titles in girls singles, girls doubles, and mixed doubles from 1959 to 1968. It's a long run. In Eastern Union County, she was the women's champion in 1964, 1965, and 1966. She was also the Union County mixed doubles champion in 1968. Then we went pro. Then we turned professional. The United States Professional Tennis Association out of 75,000 members, she was the 173rd woman to be certified by the Professional Tennis Association. She was recognized for 35 years of service to the United States Professional Tennis Association and left with something called elite professional status given to her in 2017. Additionally, she started and created the nationally recognized Hot Shot Tennis Program for children ages 5 through 7 in 1994. I'd like to bring up Candace Borges Huddeman right now.
Thank you, Bill. Because I've waited 3 years through COVID, while my hair turned gray, I'm finally here from Florida. I came from 85 degrees up to your wonderful 35 degrees. So I thought I would say a little something. At 10 years old, I used to watch my brothers play basketball and Little League baseball. The most I could do was ask my brother Guy if I could shoot a few hoops with him up in the back lot, or play softball with the boys in the neighborhood. There were no organized sports for girls back then. My mother knew that I could run as fast as any boy on the block, and I could hit a baseball as far as they could, but there was nothing for me to do. She read in the Cranford Chronicle that the Cranford Recreation Department was offering free tennis lessons. So she went to a thrift store and bought me a tennis racket. It was a strange looking one. It looked like a snowshoe and was half my size. I rode 3 to 4 miles every day up to Walnut Avenue School to take free tennis lessons. At the end of the summer, I won the girls 12 and under championship. And as they say, the rest is history. Have all my dreams come true? Some have, some haven't. I never played Wimbledon, but I didn't grow up when girls' athletic prowess was recognized or appreciated. And I didn't have parents that knew the first thing about tennis. All my father's attention in sports were directed towards his son. So if I hadn't been for the free lessons offered here in Cranford, who knows? I may not have enjoyed the years of playing and teaching the sport that I love. I've been a USPTA teaching pro for 40 plus years. I've been married for 51 years. And I've raised 3 wonderful sons. But because I was doing what I loved, I don't feel like I've worked a day in my life. Thank you, Cranford, for the chance to have such a wonderful, fulfilling life and career.
Candace? Oh. Well spoken. Well spoken. Good job. There you
go. Oh, my.
That's for you.
No gray hair.
A quick picture. Wait. Hang on, kiddo. All right.
And I believe I'm the oldest inductee here tonight.
All right. Congratulations, Candace, the oldest and possibly funniest here in the room. All right, our next committee member, I'd like to call up Miss Kathy Gilbert.
I'm so glad I didn't get to sing the Star Spangled Banner. Looking out, seeing so many familiar faces, so many former students. Great to see a lot of the parents that I've got to work with over the years, former colleagues. You heard Title IX mentioned already. A lot of the athletes that are going to receive awards tonight, female athletes, are the beneficiaries of Title IX. They've gone on to become engineers and doctors. So we owe Title IX and equal rights a big plus, and just keep that in mind because we all want the best for our young women. So after a 40-year career as a health and physical education teacher in Cranford, I retired in July. I got to work with a lot of wonderful athletes. And when you start working with them, you're like, oh, if there's a Hall of Fame someday, this kid's going to be in it. Well, that is very true of Taylor. Taylor D'Antico was one of those kids that the minute they walked in the gym, they didn't want to leave. So I'm just going to read off some of her accomplishments, least of all being a doctor. So Dr. D'Antico. Cranford High School class of 2010, graduated from the University of Maryland, and Rutgers University doctorate. 2018. Soccer, basketball, and softball athlete. All right, three-year varsity letter winner, team captain for soccer in 2009, Union County champions, Mountain Valley Conference champions 2009, first team all Mountain Valley Conference 2008, 2009, and second team all Union County in 2008. Basketball, which I really enjoyed coaching Taylor, three-year varsity letter winner, team captain 2009, 2010, state sectional champions in 2010, first team All-Mountain Valley Conference 2009-2010, state sectional finalist in 2009. Softball, three-year varsity letter winner, team captain in 2010. She had a lot of great leadership skills, this girl. Central New Jersey Section 2 Group 2 champs, New Jersey State sectional champion, New Jersey State finalist in 2009. Union County champions 2008-2010, Mountain Valley Conference champions 2008-2009-2010. They were on a roll. All right, first team all Union County, first team all conference, third team all state, group three. I can still remember her jumping in the air at the end of that game. Awards and scholarships. NJSIA Annual Scholar Athlete Award, Senior Leadership Award 2010, three-time Athlete of the Week 2009-2010, William Ray and Paul Brown Soccer Scholarship, and Cranford Soccer Club Thomas E. Salinardo Athletic Scholarship 2010. Ladies and gentlemen, I present you Dr. Taylor D'Antico.
All right. Well, Candace's speech is pretty much a very tough act to follow, but spoken like a true Floridian, I guess I'll go next and try and keep up with Candace. So, I feel incredibly humbled and honored to be standing here today. Who would have thought 12 years after graduating from Cranford High School, I'd be inducted into the Sports Hall of Fame? Quite frankly, probably everybody except me. At the time, I didn't totally realize I was really good at sports. I just thought other people weren't trying hard enough. Anyways, 12 years may have passed, but I wouldn't be the person I am today without my education and athletic career at CHS and with Cranford Sports in general. Through the sports feeder programs, I've learned some incredibly valuable lessons, whether it be teamwork, patience, and having a common purpose and goal, among many others. I think the right people are placed in your life right when you need them, and I can confidently say my path has been surrounded by those impactful people. I have to thank the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame Committee, in addition to all of my coaches who helped mentor and mold me as an athlete and as a person, with a special shout out to Coach Gilbert, Mikowitz, Huber, and Bruno my senior years, and then my teammates, whose passion, drive, and talent made me a better player throughout the years. And especially my family, who spent countless hours driving me to and from practices and games and for always showing up for me. I think it's important to enjoy the people and opportunities placed in your life while you have them. Let people help coach you and make you a better athlete and person, and continue working alongside your people and teammates to work towards that common purpose. I feel both lucky and blessed to have had such a wonderful and impactful upbringing in Cranford sports while being surrounded by some of the best. So thank you. Thank you for the incredible honor, but also thank you for helping me become the person I am today. And for that, I am forever grateful.
At this time, I'd like to call up head wrestling coach Pat Gorman to introduce our next inductee.
There you go. Thank you, Darren. I would like to start off by congratulating all the inductees and the athletes tonight. tonight's your night, and I also want to thank you. As I look around the room, I see a lot of coaches and mentors that have come back and given back to the community, and you've also set the bar very high for our current athletes, and Cranford Athletics wouldn't be where it is without you guys, so thank you very much. The real reason I'm here is to introduce Nick Ficchetti. Yeah. I was lucky enough to have been a teammate of Nick's for as long as I can remember wrestling. And if you've heard the name in Cranford, you probably know him as the guy who was a football player, the guy who was a varsity football player for 95, 96, 97. He was a team captain in 96 and 97. He was a varsity letter winner for 3 years as a wrestler. He only wrestled for 3 years due to an injury his freshman year. But during those years, he never lost a county match. He never lost a match at the districts or the region level. He was a three-time placer at the states with a fifth, a third, and a runner-up as a senior. Nick went on to wrestle at Michigan State University, where he was an All-American. He was on the U.S. National Freestyle Team in 1995 and 2006. He was a national runner-up in the freestyle in the U.S. Open in 2006 and 2008. He was in the Olympic trials where he placed fifth, and he was a Pan Am champ. Now, if you know Nick, you know he's much more than that. And anybody in this room that has spent time with him knows he has the biggest heart in this room. He would give you the shirt off of his back. Nick came up to New Jersey from Florida this week and spent some time with our PAL wrestlers, giving them a little bit of back to from what he got out of Cranford. Today, he took time out of his day to come see the high school team and tell them what wrestling meant and how it shaped him into becoming the man that he is now. So I thank Nick for all of that. During the 90s, Nick Ficchetti, his association with Cranford Wrestling is what kept us relevant. Without Nick Ficchetti, Cranford Wrestling isn't what it is today. So I'd like to invite Nick up here. Please give him a round of applause. Nick Ficchetti.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming. First of all, let's just give a round of applause for Cranford. I've lived a lot of places, seven or eight, in the last 15 years, and what a wonderful place to grow up. Come on, Cranford. First off, I want to give thanks to the high school, the sports programs, the PAL, the Parks and Recreation Department, Coach Kevin Murray, Coach Pat Gorman, Coach Torsone for making this happen. I know we've been delayed for a couple of years. And also congratulations to all the inductees tonight. I'd like to start off with a little story that I heard, and perhaps you guys have heard before too. There was this man that was climbing a mountain. And he's nearing the summit of the mountain. And all of a sudden he falls. And he's hanging onto a branch by the skin of his teeth. And he frantically calls out, "Please help! Somebody help me! Anybody!" He calls to the summit. All of a sudden he hears a voice come down to him. And it's the voice of God. "I'm here. It's me, my son. It's God. I need you to let go and trust me." So the climber thinks there for a second. He sits and he thinks. All of a sudden, he yells back up to the summit, "Is there anybody else up there?" Of all the life lessons that I've learned in the sport of wrestling, the lesson of letting go stands out the most. Now, it all began with the story for me, all began with my father signing me up at the local PAL. Now, I thought I was joining Hulk Hogan and Junkyard Dog, but it wasn't exactly that, And so we walked into this little dungeon room, and I see these pictures on the wall. I saw guys like Coach Pete Schultz, Sammy Richardson, who's no longer with us. I saw Kenny Hartman, their plaque with their name on it. And I said, you know what? I want my name up there too. Very simple, just a simple goal. Now, I didn't realize how long and what a marvelous, epic, and arduous journey it would take to eventually get there. Filled with tragedy, triumphs, victories, losses. But ultimately, the goal of this was to, and I'm not saying I'm wise, was a path of wisdom. Now, the sport of wrestling, if used correctly, mimics the process of life, as do all sports, but I think wrestling's a little bit more concentrated. Learning how to properly win, how to properly lose, how to process that information, how to stay present in all that you do. But ultimately, how to properly let go when it's time. I want to thank my mother and father, Peter and Irene, for their unconditional love and their support in my life. Without them, I'm nothing. I'd like to thank my brothers, Paul and Eric, for their daily beatings that they gave me to toughen me up, as well as Coach Schreiner and Coach Mack out here, too. Appreciate those beatings. The town of Cranford for being such a wonderful place to grow up, and what a blessing it is to be here. And I'd like to thank all my coaches and training partners and all the people that were involved in the successes that I've had. I love you all. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Nick. Our next committee member, I'm going to call up Kathy Savage at this time.
Okay, 7 years ago, we inducted Michelle Charney into the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame as an outstanding gymnast. This next inductee should have been inducted along with her. The combo boosted the team to 2 Union County champion titles and 4 trips to the state sectional finals. Kim was named first team all-county and a state sectional all-around finalist all 4 years of high school. She was the uneven bar champion, balance beam, and all-around runner-up in the Bulldog Invitational, Union County all-around champion, and runner-up on the beam and floor exercise. Her senior year, she was the North Jersey Section 2 uneven bar and balance beam champion and all-around runner-up. Kim was Effinger's Athlete of the Week, New Jersey Scholar Athlete, and Booster Club Scholarship winner. After high school, Kim attended NCAA Division I James Madison University, where she continued her gymnastic prowess on bars and beam, earning accolades as the Athletic Director Scholar Athlete and Academic All-American. I was honored to coach her and am proud to introduce to you Kimberly Kupka Donatella.
Oh, tears. So when Kathy called me back in early 2020 to let me know I'd been selected for induction into the Hall of Fame, it came as a big surprise and an unexpected honor. My high school gymnastics career began after moving from Edison to Cranford at the start of my freshman year. Even though the move was tough, little did I know the impact it would have on me. Participating on Cranford's team became the most memorable part of my high school years. As a very shy teenager who started high school in a new town, this team was such an important part of my high school days because with gymnastics, I was in my element and comfort zone. I have many people to thank for supporting me along the way. My parents, of course, for all the time and miles they drove, taking me to and from long practices and competitions, many of which were out of state for my club team. To my dad for building a balance beam that I could use in our house when I first started doing gymnastics at 5 years old. to my mom for nominating me to the Hall of Fame. I'm pretty sure it was her handwriting on the nomination form that was submitted not long after I graduated, even though she may not even remember doing that. To Michelle, we were friends from our club team even before I knew we'd end up in the same high school. Then she took me under her wing when I came to Cranford, and she introduced me to Kathy. I still laugh when I think of her dancing around practices singing Aretha Franklin's Respects. To my club coaches, they laid the groundwork and taught me the gymnastic skills I needed to compete at a higher level in high school and beyond at James Madison University. To Kathy for working with me and the others who competed on club teams so that we could participate both on those teams while also being part of our high school athletic programs. Plus, she always encouraged me to perform the skills that I might have been hesitant to do. And to the Hall of Fame committee, thank you for voting me in back in 2020. I just want to say congratulations to everyone else that's being inducted here tonight.
Congratulations, Kimberly. At this time, I'd like to call up our head football coach, Eric Rosenmeier.
It's a little higher. Good evening. I have the great honor of welcoming Jessica McCoy to the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame. I feel very fortunate to have been a staff member during Jess's time at Cranford High School. I can tell you firsthand that she is the epitome of what a Cranford athlete strives to be. First and foremost, she was a citizen of the school and of the community. I defy you to find someone that knows her that didn't both like and respect her. Second, she was a National Honor Society student whose major at Case Western Reserve was structural engineering. Finally, she was a multi-sport athlete that not only thrived as an individual, but brought multiple championships back to Cranford. Here are some of her highlights. As a high school member, she was a member of the National Honor Society. In field hockey, she was a three-year starter at goalkeeper, first-team all-county, and first-team all-state group three. Basketball, second all-time women's leading scorer with 1,276 points. North Jersey Section 2 Group 3 champion twice, 2010, 2013. Second team All-County in 2011-2012, second team All-Conference 2011, first team All-County and All-Conference in 2012 and 2013, third team All-State All Groups, New Jersey North-South All-Star Game in 2013. At Case Western, it's Case Western Reserve, which I think means they reserve the right to keep you out unless you're really, really smart. So while she was there majoring in structural engineering, she was a four-year starter, played 100 games, two-time captain, scored 1,134 points. Yes, she's a 1,000-point scorer twice. Eighth best in school history, led the team in rebounds, assists, steals, and shooting, where you're playing by yourself. We're the only one there. All right. University Athletic Association, all-academic team, all-University Athletic Association second team, top 10 in school history in points, field goals made, field goal percentage, three-point field goals, and three-point percentage, and free throw percentage, where she is first in the history of the school. People often ask me what the criteria is for a Hall of Famer, and while that could be hard to express at times, I know what a Hall of Famer looks like when I see one. It looks like Jess McCoy. Please welcome Jessica McCoy to the Cranford Athletic Hall of Fame.
Oh, guys, that was too good. How do I follow it up? To start with, I want to thank my family because it's easy. And they've been very supportive through my entire career. I have parents who have been great. I have sisters who have been infants and have showed up to my games and have screamed, but been excited for them, so they've been wonderful. I have uncles who have pushed me harder than ever before, and aunts. I'm very thankful for them, but mostly I'm thankful for the community that has supported me in this entire thing, which has been coaches from Gilbert to Dyer, who has nominated me, to Chapman, everybody who has molded me, and in a different sport that was basketball, who has carried me through college. In a different sport of field hockey, I've had Snyder and Burke. I've had Bruno for softball. I cannot be more thankful for the group that has molded me and the community that has brought me here, who carries me through life and experiences and just guiding what I want to be when I get older, even though I'm older. And I've never been more thankful for it. I don't have much more to say except that I'm thankful for the community that has brought me here, the family that has brought me here, the friends that have brought me here, and that I wouldn't change this experience for anything else, and that I think it has built me up to be what I am today and to kind of carry on the message of who I think should be out there in terms of career, family, friends, and experience. So I thank you to the heart of my heart. Thank you, guys. And thank you.
And a picture.
Congratulations, Jessica. All right. All right, this time I'm going to call up committee member Chris Polito.
So I actually came here very prepared, had a whole long speech prepared, actually had the plaque memorized, and then found out that I'm not introducing Mike Snyder tonight. So I guess I missed the last meeting and there were some changes made. And thanks, Chuck. I know who I have. So I guess nobody volunteered to introduce this next guy, so I guess since he's my brother-in-law, they figured I would be the one to do it. So I'm honored to introduce Timothy Meyer, Cranford High School. Graduated in 1999, and based on the applause he got when he walked in, everybody probably knows him. He's your friendly fireman when he's awake. Police fire jokes, Mike. You can understand that, right? Timmy was first team all in Union County in 1999. He was also the Union County Player of the Year. He's a first team All-State Group 3 player. His senior year, wow, Timmy, that's pretty good. 531 batting average, 9 doubles, 3 triples, 3 homers, 52 RBIs. His pitching career, he was 15-0 over the course of his 4 years, 8-0 as a senior with a 2.01 ERA. Congratulations, buddy.
Good evening. When I first heard I was being inducted into the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame, I was deeply honored to receive this prestigious award. Hearing the names of all the other athletes and teams being honored tonight is truly humbling to be in the same company as these great athletes. I would like to start by thanking the Hall of Fame committee for recognizing my baseball accomplishments. Baseball has always been a huge part of my life. I would also like to thank my family, especially my wife, who has been my number one fan since high school, and I'd still like to think she's my number one fan today. I'm grateful for my daughters, Addison, Savannah, and my son, Sean, allowing me to still love the game that I enjoy playing and watching, even though some days we have long talks in the car about somebody going 0-for-4 and things they could have done better. I would like to thank my parents for being there for me on Little League, carting me around, taking me from practice to practice, And even on the most important day in their life, their wedding day, them allowing me to miss the wedding and attend a Little League baseball game. I would like to thank my coaches, especially Coach Mack, for his continuous dedication to building such a strong baseball program. It's easy to see how so many Cranford ballplayers have succeeded through their high school years and beyond when you have such a successful role model leading their path. And of course, my teammates were sitting there in the corner. Without them, I wouldn't be here recognized tonight. I was lucky enough to play with so many talented athletes that it made it very easy to be successful on this team. So thank you again for this honor.
Congratulations, Timmy. And just a reminder to our inductees, those plaques are yours to keep. We have a separate plaque that goes in the Hall of Fame at the high school. Our next committee member that I'd like to introduce to you is Christy White. Christy, could you come up at this time?
I did bring notes this time. So not only did I have the honor to be on the gymnastics team with Kim, who was inducted tonight, but I got to compete with Maggie and get to know Maggie through high school and college and watch her actually have a high jumper go against a cross-country runner once. She don't remember because she was gone, probably in the car with her dad in New Jersey by the time I finished. But getting to know Maggie and being a part of her career and watching it grow was absolutely amazing. So Maggie Morrow graduated Cranford in 1991, University of Pennsylvania in 1995. In cross country, there's so many things here, I don't know if I can read them all, but I'm gonna go through some of the big highlights. She was Uni County champion, first place, 89 and 90. New Jersey sectional champion, third place. Group three, meet of champions, 12th place in 1990. Third team All-State in 1990 and named to All-Century Union County team in 1990. Should have brought the glasses. winter track and field, indoor. She was Union County champ in the 1600 and the 3200. She was sectional champ, group three champ, in the 1600, New Jersey meet of champions, third place. Eastern States Championship, four-time first team All-Union County, spring track. So Maggie just continued all year round, ran all year round in circles, lots of circles. She was Union County champ, second place in 16 and 3200 in 1990. Then she was first place in the 16 and the 3200. New Jersey sectional champion, second place, 16 and 3200. Group three champion, third place, 3200. Oh, geez. New Jersey meet of champions, second place, 3200. She set the school record at 11 minutes and 2 seconds. Undefeated dual meet record. She went to the Keebler Invitational out in Chicago. I've heard about that trip many a times. Union County Girls Track Spring Track Championship Outstanding Athlete and Union County Scholar Athlete. I know I missed a couple, but Maggie, you're amazing. You always have been amazing, and it's a very honor to give you this award.
Thank you, Christy. You are an honor to run with, too. Thank you so much for this honor. It's so special to me. Running has been just a huge part of my life and really shaped me in so many different ways. I met my husband through running. My daughter runs now, so it's really such a special honor to me. There's three people I'd like to thank specifically. The first one is my older brother, Matt. He was a runner, and he was my inspiration from first running the Cranford Chronicle 1 mile run with him to going to all of his meets, which leads me to my second person, who is my father, for dragging me to all of my brother's meets, to Warrenako, to Homedale, but watching him run and thinking, yeah, I think I want to do that too. To my father also, my biggest fan, no pressure, but solid support. I don't think he missed a single meet. He listened to me when I said, don't talk to me before a race, hi, don't let me see you. He did everything I needed him to do. His support was great. And the last person is Mr. White, my coach. Not only was he a phenomenal coach, really just the best, but it was his belief in me that really helped me make the runner that I was. So thank you. Thank you all. Thanks a lot.
Congratulations, Margaret. At this time, I'd like to call Chuck Archdeacon back up to the microphone.
I don't mind coming up here so much because my knees get really stiff when I sit too long. This next inductee, I had just had the best time talking to him. Talked to him so many times on the phone, talked to him. You know, you never realize how many stories come out of these inductees, really how much they accomplished and all the stuff they did and who their friends were, who their coaches were, and how much time they actually spent in the travels they did around and all this stuff. Well, this next inductee was just fabulous. Now, he specialized. He was a javelin thrower. And let me just give you what this man accomplished. He is, and he has some great stories, by the way. So ask him if you see him. Van Shaw graduated in 1973 from Cranford High School and 1977 from Rice University. Throwing the javelin, he was a varsity letter winner from 1970 to 1973. He was undefeated in all dual meets, Union County champion 1972-1973. State of meet champs, all groups champion 1972 through meet record of 220 feet. Group 4 state champion 1972-73. Eastern States champion 1973, second longest throw in the nation in 1973, 231 feet, 10 inches. Selected all conference, all county, and all state, all groups, 1972-1973. Invited to the Golden West Invitational, 1973, only top 8 in the nation were invited. Invited to throw for the Brooklyn Track Club, most elite high school students. College and amateur athletes in the tri-state area during the summers of 1972 and 1973. He went on to throw the javelin. He received a 4-year scholarship to Rice University. He won numerous meets between 1974 and 1976. He set a Rice University meet record versus Baylor of 218 feet. Let me introduce to you one phenomenal javelin thrower, Van Shaw.
So I did kindergarten through fourth grade at Brookside. Anybody go to Brookside? And I went to Pingree for a few years, but they didn't have any women there, so I quit, went to St. Mike's for a year, and then came over to Orange Avenue, and I was walking home. Where's Mike Dow? Yeah, I was walking home one afternoon, and I had to cut across the high school field, and Zeebo and Mike Dow were out there throwing the javelin, and so all of a sudden I see this thing land out in front of me, and I look over and these guys are laughing and everything. So I picked up and threw it back, and I said, hey, that's not too bad. So I said, you know, maybe I should go out for track, because Coach White was the coach, and I had just been kicked off the basketball team for not wearing a tie. And it wasn't that, it's just that it was, I was told I wouldn't start at a game, and I walked out of the gym, and so that was it. So it was kind of tough coming back to work under Coach White and everything, but I got off a 133 as a freshman, 175 as a sophomore, 220 in my last throw of the year at the state meet as a junior, and 231 as a senior. But, you know, it's kind of what I remember. Because this is a long time from now. Why did this happen now? If you would have hung around a little bit, Chuck, we could have done this posthumously, and I could have saved the 2 plane tickets, the hotel, and the car rental. So anyway, but what I remember is I used to party out in the woods. I was just a total misfit. And I'd get up in the morning and look out my window while I'm drinking coffee, and here's Mike Agostino, who's my neighbor on the track team, all bundled up running down the street, doing two-a-days all year long and everything. I just said, man, this guy is amazing. And Mike was amazing. Mike Roach and all these people were amazing. The coaches were amazing. I need to thank Don Schott and Ray Ward, who coached me in soccer. I had a detention one day, and they knew that the game would begin the minute the detention let out. It was like 3 to 3:30, the game, and it was against Union. And, Union is tough. And in the second half of the game, I was the center halfback because I could run forever. I couldn't kick the ball that well, but I was really good on defense. So I was down in the left corner going up against their fullback. We had kicked the ball down there, and he kicked me right in the leg, and I raised my fist, and Ray Ward said, don't hit him. And the other coach said, no, don't hit him. And I'm glad I didn't, because it was Ray Liotta. And if you would have seen Goodfellas and everything, I'm glad I didn't touch him, because I definitely would not be here tonight. And I really need to thank, not only, Coach Sachs, he cared more about you than he did about the sports. Ray White was the ultimate sportsman. So I had that. We didn't have a track. We had no home. So I had to walk across town to Hillside from Orange or the high school. And I met my wife, Leslie. And we met in Orange Avenue in summer school learning to study for the All-State choir tryouts, and that's where I met her. And we did All-State, but the second year in All-State, Dr. Post wouldn't let me go because I didn't have the character, and it just broke my heart. I couldn't sing the second year. It was a painful thing for me and my mother, but I'm still married to her, and we went to Orange Avenue today, and they led us into the music room where we met back in the summer of 71 and took pictures of us. So it's all working out good. In college, I didn't go to Rice for the sports. I actually got 200 colleges that were interested in me, because only half the states threw the javelin. And I could have probably gone to Oregon, Tennessee, Texas, all these. But I went to Rice because when I went down there, the people were really smart. And I knew I was smart, but I just didn't know in what way. I got 4 D's and an F my freshman year. But after that, I learned how to read. I had no attention span. I couldn't. I'd read for it, and I go, what did I just read? I have no idea. And here I am with all these people where almost all of them were one or two in their senior class. So it was quite a trip. I had no coach the whole time I was there. They only coached the runners, and they got us a gym membership in Bel Air, Texas. I couldn't even work out at the school. And you remember when the Nautilus came out in the 70s, the Nautilus machines, you old guys? Oh, they were the big thing because they came out of Miami and the Dolphins had won the Super Bowl. And so I'm in this gym, but I didn't really like the Nautilus machines. Me and the other guys on the team, all we did was deadlift, snatch, clean and jerk. That was pretty much our workouts. But I had bad knees. They were in terrible pain. So they operated on me my sophomore year. Right before spring break, they brought me back from the hospital, both knees sent on the back of a pickup truck, and carried me back up to my room. If it wasn't for the heart of a few students that, like me, didn't have enough money to go anywhere over spring break, I had to stay on campus, fed me that week. But the doctor said, I want you to go back and get on that Nautilus machine and start doing these leg extensions, just 5 pounds. So here I am. And, of course, this is the place where the Houston Oilers worked out in the summer. So I'm in there, with my 5 pounds on the thing. And who walks in? Now, tell me, raise your hand if you remember, but Big John Matuszak. Okay, so John Matuszak walks in the room, and he sees me doing these 5-pound leg extensions. And I said, oh, shit, I'm in. This is embarrassing. Man, you got to put some weight on there, man. You got to say, and you remember, you finished the sentence for me. You know you're going to bruise. Who knows it? When you cruise with the twos. He was he was really famous. It was like the Hulk Hogan of the NFL and everything. But in spite of that, I did get through college. I did graduate on time. I won the Baylor Invitational and got a watch and a gold medal from Mickey Mantle, who was a really great experience for me. I got to meet some great people and everything, but I'm a guy that failed a lot along the way, and because I had the kind of parents I did who grew up under tough conditions, I learned not to stay down, and I attribute everything that's happened in my life was from learning how to get back up after being very, very, you know, hurt by other people because of my behavior and everything. And it led for me, I've just, in my 25th year of teaching this kind of stuff in the prison, and I'm in the federal penitentiary about to go into the supermax where all the bad guys are, the bombers and the drug dealers and all that. And I teach yoga and breathing and relaxation and meditation, and said, and that wasn't part of the curriculum. So I'm not going to do it unless you let me do this. And they did it. A couple of weeks ago, the warden of the prison deposited 15 yoga mats in my classroom and everything because of the feedback that she was getting. So all I can tell you, what I've learned from Coach White and from Coach Sachs and from Coach Shod and from Coach Ward and Coach Corey, I didn't realize the humility that they had. But you were made, you were created humble, and you were created to listen, you were created to serve. And when you get all the junk off of you that happens to you and just get back to that, to the very, very core of you, you'll be the most intelligent and happiest person you'll ever be. Thank you.
All right, congratulations, Sylvana Shaw. And thank you for that speech. Very entertaining. All right, next up, it's an honor and pleasure for me to introduce this next honoree. There's an old saying in wrestling. Actually, it's a quote from a movie, Vision Quest. It's not about the 6 minutes. It's about what happens in that 6 minutes. With Coach Schreiner, it's not about the 3 years he coached for Cranford High School. It's about what happened in those 3 years that made his coaching career very special. He was 71-8 over his 3-year coaching career. I'll say that one more time. He was 71-8 over 3 years. I'll add a Group 3 state championship and a New Jersey Star Ledger Coach of the Year to that. What made his coaching career even more special was Coach Schreiner's lifetime commitment to the PAL and CBSL programs. Jamie Schreiner is someone that you call on when you need help, sort of like a superhero that swoops in and saves the day. His endless hours of volunteerism, coaching, and mentorship to so many is appreciated by all, especially many of us in this room. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege to introduce you, Coach Jamie Schreiner.
It's not that long, it's just pictures, because I work off of pictures. I don't know. I don't know if I can follow that act, but I'm going to try. Thank you, Darren. Thank you to the committee, and congratulations to all our inductees. I've been very fortunate to cross paths with most of the people on the list tonight. So it's like, throughout my 32 years being affiliated with Cranford, I've met some great people. I want to start in 1990. I'm not going to give you too many dates, but that's an important date because that's the day I walked into central office at Lincoln School for an interview for a phys ed job with football, wrestling, and baseball attached to it. I said, oh, this is perfect. Problem was, I was met by Dr. Lukash, who had someone he wanted, Mr. Figman over at Hillside, he wanted someone else, and the third guy looked like a character out of The Sopranos named Gary Sorrentino. And he was told, there's a guy I need you to take. So I was the wild card. So I did my best. I walked out, and Gary Sorrentino called me an hour later and said, you got the job. So I want to thank him because he not only shaped my career, he's been a great friend for 32 years, Gary Sorrentino. I want to thank my family, all my friends, all the people who jumped the fence at Frenchie's and came over from Roosevelt Park to this dinner tonight. I appreciate it. A lot of coaches are here, cousins. I want to thank my wife. I met my wife in Cranford, so I want to thank Cranford for that. She saved me in many ways, but if it wasn't for Cranford, I never would have met her, my wife Debbie. I want to give a little shout out to Bob Lely. You know, we're talking about the 96, 97, 98 years of baseball. I met Bob in 1990 and I was chomping at the bit. But Bob, you know, he had people in place and he would always say to me, "Ah, Jimmy, you're peeing vinegar, you'll get your time," you know. So, you know, finally Bob gave me an opportunity and I was very fortunate to have some great kids in baseball. I mean, lunch pail kids, tough kids, smart kids. It was perfect because along with an outstanding coach named Dennis McCaffrey, you might have heard of him, we were able to take these boys and basically say, we're going to change the culture. We're going to have to beat Elizabeth, Scotch Plains, Westfield, Union. I'm tired of them shutting us out. That can't happen when we take over. So, you know, we punched a little bit. We were aggressive. We stole your ball bag. When the coaches for the other team would come out and argue, Coach Mack had a horn that he released off his pocket. It was a little guerrilla warfare, but we had to change the culture. And what a great partner to have, to tell a young man out of Roosevelt Park, Villanova, played in the minor league system for the California Angels. I had the best people. Scott Birmingham went to East Carolina, Terry Hanratty, just great baseball people. Knew how to scout, knew how to steal signs, just all the things you had to do, cutoffs, bunting. But if it wasn't for these kids, we wouldn't be able to do that. And I don't want to touch too much on that because they're going to be called up here later and they'll speak about that. But I just want to note that I'm really proud of those. They're men now, but I look over at them. I still feel like it's 1997. And, you know, it's just a wonderful time. Coach Torsone talked about the recreation in Cranford and the PAL, and I want to thank them for giving me an opportunity. And in 2008, when I rode down Spruce Street by Brookside School, and I said, it's like Field of Dreams. If you buy this house, your kids will play in that field at Brookside endlessly. And then my wife says, we can't afford that house. But we found a way. We found a way, and she works very hard every day that we can keep that house. And we've been in Cranford since 2008 as residents, and that allowed me to get involved into the PAL and the Cranford baseball. And I just want to thank a few people before I step away from the mic. When it came to PAL football, obviously the PAL board and Brian McGovern allowing me to take very large rosters, 50, 60 kids, split them into two teams so everyone had a chance to play. That was important. I could not stand when kids did not get into the ball game and standing on that sideline. But as you see, well, because of stuff like that, you go to a Friday night game and Coach Rosemeyer has 75 kids along that sideline. And that's what you have to do down below. You cannot discourage these kids. You've got to keep them going. And I'm just so proud when I sit in those bleachers and I count. And it's 70 plus kids every year. So I want to thank the PAL for allowing us to get that started early and keep those kids involved. PAL Wrestling. Kevin Murray, who has brought Cranford PAL Wrestling to another level from, yeah. Yes, Kevin. Yeah. You know, a program that had 30 kids now has 135 in a waiting list. So thank you, Kevin, for all your work there. And of course, youth baseball, the Cranford Baseball League, Kevin Weatherall for allowing me to get T-ball into the town of Cranford. Back in the day, you had to go to Kenilworth for that. I tried to register my youngest son, and they told me he was too young, and I went to Kevin. I said, you got to get T-ball, and with him and the board, they did do that, and I appreciate that. And also our summer leagues. You know, you have a lot of A teams, but you also hear the word B team. Well, those kids are getting an opportunity to play also. And we took, again, multiple groups and split them up and made sure everyone was playing in the summer. I know lacrosse is a very popular sport, but I love baseball, and I did not want to lose those kids. And I know if I lost them, they would have went to another sport. So we did keep them, and having those multiple teams helped, and I want to thank the Cranford Youth Baseball for that. And just a few volunteers that they're the unsung heroes. They don't have to be there anymore. These are the guys, their kids are not involved anymore, their family's not involved anymore, but they keep showing up and you see them throughout the town. Brian Bradford, Gary Urbanski, Kurt Petchow, Rob Kannerman, Mike Plick, Bobby Kelly, Rich Miola, John Obochinski, and Bobby Bruns, and of course TV 35, which does a great job, Ed Davenport, Chris Hoffman, and their staff. These people, you know, they keep everyone informed down in Florida, out in Hawaii, just by telecasting those games. And those volunteers, you guys are the best. I do want to end with thanking three gentlemen and a fourth who helped shape me growing up. High school football coaches here, John Wagner, and high school baseball coach Jack Shaw from Roselle Park. Sam Appello's out in New Mexico. But those guys helped shape me and helped me get into the coaching field with all their great wisdom and how they prepared for things. And of course, Eric Rosenmeyer, Pat Gorman, and Dennis McCafferty. Between those six gentlemen, that's over 110 years of coaching, guys that stayed in place, didn't move on like me after 3 years and go somewhere else because the money was better. But these are gentlemen that were entrenched in their jobs, and that's what makes the programs better, consistency. And my final thank you goes out to my superintendent that I grew up with over in Roselle Park. Most superintendents don't have time to even know where the ball field is or go to the gym. Well, our superintendent, Mr. Ernest J. Finizio, is here. He was at every event. He was in the bleachers during the wrestling match. He was the guy yelling at the official when he made a bad call. But he was there. He was there for me, my family, and for our students. He would send notes to us. Congratulations, it would be called a splash in the news, and you would get it in the mail, and he'd write a little note, and I still remember the handwriting of what you did. So I want to thank him. He was so good, they named an elementary school after him back in Roselle Park. So thank you to everyone, and I look forward to coming up with that 97 team later.
I met my wife in the music room at Orange Avenue Middle School in 1979. So, it's a hot spot, I guess. That's true. I'd just like to thank Chad and the committee for letting me just speak a moment about Mike. I'd also like to just congratulate all the other inductees tonight. I had the privilege of coaching Mike from 1997 to 2001, which sounds like 20 years ago, but, and it is 20 years ago, but it does seem like yesterday when, at certain times when you stop and think about some of the games and some of the things that Michael accomplished. Mike had all the characteristics that would lead him here tonight. He had natural athletic ability, humility. He had a competitive drive, and he had a love of the game. His combination of skill and relentless motor separated him from his peers. He worked harder than any player that I coached during my 15 years of coaching. He was the best player on the team, but he played like he was the worst. He tried and tried and tried every single day to get better. He never took anything for granted. No moment or game was too big for him, and he rose to the occasion time and time again. Prior to Mike coming to the high school, the boys basketball program hadn't had very much success in the past 25 to 30 years. We had only played in one state playoff game in that time. Once Mike came into the building, we went the 4 years that Mike was there, we went every single year, and it culminated with us in the sectional final against Shabazz, a game that we lost, but Shabazz was the eventual state overall champion. And Mike led us to that game that night and did it in an amazing fashion. Chad talked about a 612-point season his senior year. 46 in one game. In his 72 varsity games, he scored over 25 points 38 times. But he also led our program in assists and was the first guy to give up the ball when the situation merited it. But my favorite moment for Mike was when he scored his 1,000th point We defeated the seventh-ranked team in the state, Linden, at home that day. Mike scored his 1,000th point, and changed in that game changed the way that Cranford had been playing for the past 25 years and set a new standard that it was going to be something different going forward. I would just like to say that Mike gave me, personally, some of the greatest moments of my life. And I look back so fondly on those years that we had together. And a beautiful thing now is Mike and his wife, Megan, happy birthday, by the way, are raising their family here in Cranford. And in 10 years or so, I fully expect to see some of their guys out there on the court. I know Mike is doing Little League baseball, rec basketball, and I'm sure that he's going to have his guys up ready to go on a varsity basketball team someday. So it gives me great honor to introduce Hall of Fame inductee Mike Snyder.
Oh, what a great night. Driving here, I couldn't help but laugh, thinking, like, I've been married 15 years, and when we first got married, I told my wife, I'm like, we gotta live in Cranford, it's this awesome town. And, like, by the way, I got 100 relatives that live in town, and you're gonna see them, like, everywhere you go, but it's gonna be great. And then on her 21st birthday, which is tonight, she's gotta come to the Mike Snyder Hall of Fame dinner, so. Meg, we love you. Thank you for always supporting us. And me and the boys are going to, you know, hopefully spoil you this weekend. But to everyone that put tonight together, thank you. So to Cranford Hall of Fame, to Chris Polito for helping, you know, get me inducted, to Cranford Athletics, to the PAL program, to all the athletes. Tonight's an awesome night. And some of you guys I haven't seen in probably 20 years. Some of you guys I probably see too much. But that's a testament to Cranford, right? A lot of guys have, you know, kind of mentioned that, just you know, seeing everyone, you know, around town, giving back, coaching, and that's kind of, I think, part of the reason a lot of the sport programs are so successful. So growing up in town, I played every sport. Whatever sport was in season was my favorite. So through all the PAL programs, through all the rec programs, come 7th and 8th grade, in my head, I decided I was going to be a basketball player. So I thought, for my way to be successful, to go to college, to go to the NBA, I'm gonna play basketball. And I did everything. So I practiced. The two biggest things, I realized this at 13, I'm like, the two biggest things holding me back, one, clearly Cranford is a baseball town. Right, so you could tell tonight, I mean, this is like 96, 97, like the 25-year dynasty that's still going is just starting, and I'm leaving it to play basketball. I hated dirt, and I was like crazy ADD. The other problem, like Coach just mentioned, Cranford didn't really have a basketball program. So come eighth grade, after eighth grade, I start telling my mom, and I think a lot of parents, like when kids come up to you now, when my kids come to me with like crazy ideas, sometimes as like a good parent, you let them run with it to like, you know, kind of like, let's see where they get. I told her, I said, Mom, listen, I can't go to Cranford High School. I got to go to like a Catholic school, a private school. So I started applying to schools. I still remember. I got into some, and I got a letter from Seton Hall Prep, and I'm like, perfect. I got into Seton Hall Prep, a half scholarship. I have to pay $5,000. So I turn and show my mom, and she looks around. It's like, we got, you know, a million kids in the house. She's like, you know, good luck. So that went nowhere. So I go back to playing basketball. Come like August, September, I'm getting ready to go to high school. And I remember like it was yesterday. It's not like today where like things just go out on the internet. Like, you know, Cranford's got a new basketball coach. So you start hearing rumblings in like August, September, Cranford's got new coaches. And I'm like, thank you, Jesus. Like, Cranford's got a new coach. I'm going to the high school. I'm ready to go. And I remember it to the day I die. Like, second week in September, first week of school, I'm in the high school. It's like, meet the basketball coaches. Coach Johnstone, Coach Wheatley, who's also here tonight, Coach Baker, all show up. And Coach Johnstone shows up, young guy, good-looking guy, in a suit. And this is 1997. I mean, my richest friend growing up was a plumber. The father was, you know, there was no money in Cranford. Tom Johnstone shows up in a suit, a Mercedes. He owns a company, and he loves hoops. I'm like, I'm 100% in. So So over the next 4 years, Coach Johnstone treated the Cranford basketball program like we were Division I athletes. He got us gear. He got us sneakers. He let us travel. We went on buses. We went on planes. Went to Florida. Went to Arizona. Just kind of ran a first-class program. He made it cool to play Cranford basketball. So there was a 15-year run, probably the best run in Cranford history. And, you know, I like to think I was a small part of it, but it was really Tom Johnstone, Coach Wheatley, Coach Baker that kind of put this together through their vision of teaching a bunch of kids through hard work, dedication, being confident in yourself, you know, just kind of being, you know, having this like relentless pursuit of success. And he instilled in that us, and, you know, the whole time while being a good person and giving back. So these guys have given back more, and through high school and through college, you started hearing stories like, wow, Coach Johnstone did that, Coach Johnstone, he was helping everybody. And he instilled in that us that it was like, you know, be the best person you can be, work hard, be passionate about something, but always give back along the way. And, you know, at the time, you're thinking, this is awesome. This is all about hoops in high school. That's like what's important. As you get out of high school, get out of college, and start life, and you can trace back every one of those lessons to life. And we do that every day. So every day I get up, I think about the lessons that they taught me as far as being passionate about something, but also making sure to give back along the way. And it's, you know, it's afforded me, you know, to be able to run a great business and have, you know, I think a tremendous life. And I think at 13 or 14, we're all very vulnerable. And depending on who comes into your life, you can go left or right. And I think these guys have really allowed a ton of us to stay right, give us guidance, give us support. And, you know, I even hear from like some of the knuckleheads that were on the team, and it's like, even they're doing good. So everything you guys did worked. I appreciate it. We thank you. To this day, people come up to me and they're like, what was up with those guys? Like, those guys were crazy. They were so passionate. You're kind of like Coach Schreiner just said about baseball, just kind of having like a new, you know, like a new regime, like a new mentality, and it worked. And Cranford had a ton of success under these guys. And I know myself and the teammates cannot thank you guys enough. To my parents, life is a lot easier when you have great parents, right? So I was lucky. I had tremendous, tremendous parents, you know, supporting me every step of the way. So thank you guys. To my extended family, there, some of them are here now. They would come to all the games and everyone would be like, you know, who is this like crazy Irish mob of like 100 people? But thank you guys. We have, you know, we'll have great stories forever, some great memories. I know Coach highlighted on some of them. And, you know, to my kids, so I have three boys, Michael, Joseph, and Brendan, all playing sports now. What I try to instill in them, I call them all my kids, them and the kids I coach, is that, you know, this is it. Like, you know, the PAL programs, the rec programs, I have friends that played in high school, college, beyond college, and anytime we get together, it's all about, you know, the rec programs, the PAL programs, the high school programs. And it's not about who scored the points or who hit the shot or you know, who hit the home run. It's all about, you know, building friendships, camaraderie, learning to compete, learning about yourself, and then learning to, you know, how you're going to translate that into life. So you guys, I'm speaking to my kids, have a tremendous support system in town. Everyone in this room, I try to introduce them all the time to people in town, will support you, will do anything they can to help you, lean on them, ask them for advice. And if you guys get 10% out of 10% what I did out of Cranford, I'll be happy for you. So thank you guys. I can't thank you enough. Awesome night. Thank you.
Right, congratulations, Michael, one more time. Now, we're going to move on to the team inductions. We have a few teams being inducted here this year. We're going to start with the 1986 wrestling team. I'm going to call up Gary Urbanski, who will introduce the 86 team.
Thank you, Darren. We mentioned Van Shaw. The 1986 team would like to invite him downtown with us after this as well. you know, this has been an amazing night, and I don't know what I expected when I got here. It was something like this, but it was in my mind's eye as grand with as many people as I know and as much you know, enthusiasm and love, and I think it's a really neat experience. Thank you to the committee for putting this together. It's certainly a mountain of work, and congratulations to the other inductees, the team inductees, and the individual inductees. The jocularity and athleticism here is palpable. You know, I think we should give everyone a hand. So my teammates and I were talking about being inducted into the Hall of Fame. 1986 was 36 years ago, so we had a question, you know, what took so long and why? there's a lot of changes that take place in your mind's eye, and as time goes on, your team gets better and better and better and better. But after 36 years, although Cranford Wrestling continues to thrive, the 86 team accomplished things and dominated in an unprecedented way in 60-year history. And they also did it in what was considered the golden age of wrestling in the area and in New Jersey. To see Jamie Schreiner here, who has become a friend of mine through the PAL and through coaching, and to see the Roselle Park dudes here, it's just an amazing, you know, it's like the Crips and the Bloods are just sitting breaking bread. And they certainly got us, you know, more than we got them. But during this time, during this golden age, every team was stacked. Every team, like, brought it every night. They had a full squad, Roselle Park, Westfield, Scotch Plains. So there were no easy outs. There would be 1,000 people in Martin Gymnasium with, you know, someone snuck an air horn in there, standing room only, and it was hot. And these were like crazy, crazy events. And you just don't have that anymore. So it's amazing seeing Roselle Park here also. So what did Cougars achieve? They basically won it all. Conference championship, county championship, district, region championship, the North Jersey Section 2 Group 3 championship, and last and certainly not least, the Group 3 state champion. Cougars ended fifth in the state that year. They were the second ranked, highest ranked public school, and this was about the advent of private schools and super teams. So a group championship, they're all very important, but the group championship is coveted. And I'm here on behalf of my team to use this as a platform to tell the athletic department, you owe us a fire truck ride. Teams have gotten them for less, and we've deserved a fire truck ride, so I hope we get that soon. So there is no I in team, okay? We know that. But I'm first going to call up our team captains, because if it wasn't for those four guys, we definitely would not be here tonight. Let's see here. First, Frank Genova, of course. Now, his career was that of a Paul Bunyan story. Probably the hardest working dude and most legitimate guy as far as a teammate that has ever been. Gary Jones. Gary Jones. To go back to Frank, he had a rivalry with a Ralph Sorrentino. And this was the day you would have a dual meet, you would have a county, you'd meet in, you would have a region final, and maybe like a state section, and these guys would meet at four times in a year, and out-of-towners would come in just for that match, and the place would be just apoplectic and something out of a movie, and there are these amazing memories. Gary Jones, I think if there was one dual meet that needed to be won, and you needed points, and you needed to win, to me, it was Gary Jones, certainly one of my heroes. They should be applauded. Larry Kofsky is not here tonight. He was unable to attend. And Fred Faulkner, we lost Fred too soon and too early, and our thoughts go out to him, and we miss him like crazy. These captains were mature. They were adult beyond their years. They pulled you along. They led by example. They were just legitimate guys, and I have all the respect in the world for them. Right now, I'll call up the other teammates. How about that? Kevin Kofsky. Chris Welsh. Rob Espuga. Gary Brewer is not in attendance. Teddy Conley. Jimmy O'Donnell. Rob Buchanan. Tony Quartararo. Ronnie Maleo. Kenny Goldstein is not in attendance. And Bob Bulger. To say we were in the right place at the right time, we were all fortunate to share the opportunity to be on the same team. I know, dude. I got this, all right? He's always captaining. He's always leading, yes. We were fortunate to have an opportunity to be there at a very special time, but we had the most amazing coaching that you could ask for. And people today pay good money for the mentoring, the motivating, the molding that we received. You know, our coaches had a belief that every kid in the room was important. You know, it wasn't just Frank and Gary. It was the beginning guy. And starting as a freshman, I was affected by that and felt it. You were just as important as anyone else. So the way these coaches shaped you and brought you up when you're down, the sport of wrestling, you get knocked down a lot, and you don't always get out what you put in, and it doesn't make sense. And these coaches were just absolutely fantastic. Roy Dragon and Ronnie Ferraro. Roy is not here. I have to ask Ronnie Ferraro to come up. Chuck Ferrara was our head coach. So, very confusing, Ronnie Ferraro, Chuck Ferrara. So we referred him to Ronnie, and Coach Ferrara was coach. You know, during this time, you know, the 80s were a much different time than they are now. And the team was self-policed. So if you were late, these guys got on you. If you didn't go to a off-season workout, these guys got on you. If you weren't at, you know, if you weren't there after practice, they got on you.
You didn't do your homework.
You didn't do your homework. They got on you. So the coaches, the team, they pulled you along, and you have to know that. You know, what we called pranks, they now call hazing. We had legendary practices that were called desert conditions. I think that's now called child abuse. You know, on a snow day, I remember literally breaking into the high school. We went around the E-wing, and like you popped the doors, but they were chained, and you hoisted like the littlest guy over, and you like, got in there. And then that person ran around and opened the doors of the high school unchecked, and we had a full proper practice. And again, this is before cell phones and helicopter parents and food allergies, and we would hang out there, we would practice, we would play pickleball, shower. It was like being at the spa for the day, and then go back home. It was just a really, really glorious time, you know, to be around. Although we did come from loving parents and loving homes, in the 80s, your parents, you were kind of a nuisance to them. You know, and you had support, and they came to things, but they didn't go to, like, Kearney on, like, a Tuesday. You know, that was, like, they came to the homes, and they came to, like, the big ones, but we had love in our house, and you know, we definitely had support, but I think they call it free range now. You know, we were certainly not at-risk youths, but our coaches and our team kept you on track, and you know, they kept your feet under you, and we really, really appreciate all of you. Our head coach, Chuck Ferrara, cannot be here tonight, and this man was certainly one of a kind. Chuck was named New Jersey High School Coach of the Year in 1985 and 1986. He was on the cutting edge of diet, exercise, training, sports psychology. You know, Chuck put swag on the map, and many of us had, we had many uniforms and sweats and bags and socks and shoes, and kind of like before University of Oregon had, like, what color is your school colors like again? And, you know, we were in envy, and he gave us a swagger and, you know, a toughness. He was old school guy from Newark. And it's definitely like the first time I heard the word entitled, like, oh, you guys are entitled. I'm like, I don't even know what that means. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. And he also loved to play music loud in the wrestling room. And the band Heart, we would hear over and over and over. It was more like a prisoner of war camp than a wrestling camp. There is always a person behind the person, and Chuck, it was amazing CEO, and he always brought awesome people under him. Kirk Buttram is another coach here that came in a little later in my career and was fantastic. The guy behind the guy is Ronnie Ferraro. Ronnie was raised in Cranford. Jamie Schreiner talked about giving back, and Ronnie was very heavily involved in recreation wrestling. He coached at the high school level. He eventually was the head coach. You know, he moved on to other educational opportunities, but Ronnie was like, you know, good cop, and Ronnie had the coolness and the quiet confidence and the high energy, and he was in it for the kids, he was in it for the sport, and he was in it for the program, and you know, he was a great mentor and molder to all of us. You know, so with that said, I think all the memories and the stories and, you know, the times we will talk about later, but I know personally, I have in front of me teammates that were big brothers and mentors and just great teammates and great people. And they've evolved into even better people. We have first respondents, police and fire. We have educators. We have men of industry, leaders of industry. And they're not only great friends, they're great fathers. They're great husbands, and they're just really legitimate dudes. I thank you all for everything that you've done for me. So what is the lesson? The lesson is a long leash is okay, as I look at these guys. Independence is okay. I think we're evidence of that. We're all gonna be okay. To see everyone tonight is amazing, and I think 36 years was definitely worth the wait. It was definitely worth the wait. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, coach.
Congratulations, guys.
Thank you. All right, congratulations. 1986 wrestling.
Thanks.
Congratulations, guys.
Thanks, Eric.
Ron, thanks, Eric. Seriously.
All right, Gary, I know we spoke about 3 minutes last night. three for each athlete. I got you. All right, all right. All right, this time I'd like to call Bob Runs, who will introduce the next team.
All right, thank you very much. I am here to introduce our next team, the 1997 state championship baseball team. Like Coach Schreiner said earlier, they had to change the culture. So it was about a 26-year drought from the 1971 Cranford High School baseball championship until those boys went all the way. They were 27-2 overall. They were ranked number 2 overall in New Jersey, number 1 in Union County, and they were the North Jersey Group 3 state champions that year. At this time, I'd like to call up Coach Schreiner of that team so he can talk about his team and introduce his team. Thank you.
Man, Gary, this mic's hot. Okay. Thank you, Bobby Runs. I'm going to have the team come up, and I'm going to have Ryan Matlos speak on behalf of the team, but I do want to give some stats first, and then again turn over to Ryan and the team, and I'll announce them up from our roster book. This team finished 27-2 in 1997. We were ranked number 2 in the Star Ledger. We were number 1 public school in New Jersey. I think most importantly, we haven't talked about yet, is the gold yellow hat that you see around Cranford. Well, that was created the year before for that group. So when you see that hat, that's where it came from. As part of changing the culture, we got a new hat, and you still see that hat around town. So you see the young kids wearing the yellow gold hat with the blue rim. That was from that group. So that was an important time in our life. The pitching was amazing that year. They had an ERA of 1.38. They gave up 56 runs in 29 games. Our hitters, we batted 418 as a team. We scored 323 runs. Just an amazing group. Between Finn Fitzgerald, Richie Horn, Eric Mesner, Pat Pepe, they had a record of 20-1. And like as I said, the 1.38 ERA, this team just did everything. They hit, they pitched, they played defense, and again, they terrorized teams with their offense. I mean, we were up 8-9-0 sometimes after the first inning, and they just kept applying pressure. You know, I didn't give Coach Mack enough kudos. First of all, I want to thank him for bringing everyone out tonight. I think he bullied a lot of people into coming tonight, but that's what he's all about, like getting everyone to come together, especially for Cranford baseball. I mean, we started the program. You know, I did the first three with him, and then he took it and ran with it. And it's just amazing, like we say, the run that the team has gone on. So before I turn over to Ryan, I would like to call the team up in order. Chris Barron, Andy Jobe, Vincent D'Angelo, Joe McComb, Arush Pandya, Brian Weingart, Greg Bazilis, Eric Mesner, Kevin Feely, Bill Harnett, Finn Fitzgerald, Ryan Matlos, Rich Horn, Pat Pepe, and Chris Fatute. Come on up if you are here tonight.
Thank you, Coach. First of all, I'd like to congratulate everyone who's getting inducted today. Many of our inductees are personal friends of mine and are great people who support the Cranford community. First, I'd like to thank the Hall of Fame for nominating the team in 1997. It's truly an honor to be inducted in the Cranford Hall of Fame with so many gifted athletes. In terms of all the baseball teams I've been a part of, coaching and playing, this is definitely the most special. I personally played under the old regime before Jamie Schreiner took over as head coach. Let me tell you, coaching makes a world of difference. Coach Schreiner and Coach Mack basically turned the program overnight. The first year of the new coaching staff in 1996, we had a great record of 23-3, but we only had a conference title to show for it. After ending that 1997 season on a long Carlos Klein home run, given up by Eric Messner, it was a curveball. We vowed that the next season would be different. That's why I'd specifically like to thank Coach Schreiner and Coach McCaffrey. Their guidance and leadership led us from a disappointing 1996 season, disappointing, we're 23-3, to Cranford's first state championship since 1971. This 1997 team not only had an overall record of 27-2, but was also the Group 3 state champion, and we ended up number 2 ranked in the state. The 1997 team erased the notion that Cranford couldn't win the big one. Some of you may think that's absurd today. That was always the knock on Cranford in the 90s. They're pretty good, but couldn't win the big game. Our 1997 group would like to thank these coaches for bringing out the absolute best in these athletes. So if we could give a nice round of applause for Coach Schreiner and Coach McCaffrey, please. After many years of coaching myself, I could see firsthand how a coach can make or break your high school experience. These men were truly special individuals who made baseball competitive but fun. We were blessed to have two coaches on that staff that individually ended up winning the NJSIAA State Coach of the Year individually, which is quite an honor. Coaching isn't always about the X's and O's of a sport. Camaraderie, chemistry, just as it is, is more important in bringing a team together than actual talent. I try to incorporate many of these things to this day. Most of us would consider that three-month period one of the best times of our lives. These two men whose wit and humor coincided with making these young men buy into a baseball concept and a team concept. Everyone on that team can remember the sound of Coach Schreiner's voice yelling at umpires, punch a hole in that mask, and of course his patented, ah. Everyone on that team had their own version of the Schreiner voice, and we still probably say it today. Lots of stories and laughs. Our team was an interesting crew, to say the least. We had some quiet, reserved young men. We had some loud cheerleaders. We had choir boys. We had troublemakers. Different personalities, backgrounds, but we came to the common goal of winning baseball games. There was a lot of competition on and off the field. Sometimes we hung out. Sometimes we fought. But that was the type of unbalance that actually made us pretty good. Our team consisted of lots of talented players. Pat Pepe attended Rutgers University and Chris Barron of Montclair State. Both were Union County Player of the Years. Kevin Feely went on to pitch at Villanova. Brian Weingart went on to play minor league baseball. Andy Job, Rich Horn, Finn Fitzgerald McKenna, Vinny D'Angelo all went on to play on the D2, D3 baseball level. Greg Bazillas, Eric Messner, Arush Pandya, Joe McComb, Chris Fatu, who although didn't play baseball in college, were tremendous high school players in their own right. Eric Messner still talks about the homer and bat flip against Westfield. I could write a large book about the stories and funny anecdotes from the season of 1997, but you'll have to hang around after dinner or late night to hear those. I guess I was chosen to speak tonight because I was the de facto leader, captain of the team, whatever. But those experiences that Coach Mack and Coach Schreiner taught us how to grind and persevere, is the foundation of mental toughness many of us use today. Growing up in Cranford, playing on tournament teams, not travel teams, were some of our childhood's most cherished memories. We'd stick around after the game, watch other kids actually play their rec game at Memorial. We would talk junk and brag about how good we are, which is kind of funny because it's basically the same thing we did in high school. This type of stuff, from Little League to high school, makes Cranford such a unique and close community. It's so special to play your whole life with a certain group of kids and have your high school career end by winning the state championship. This is the stuff storybook endings are made from. I guess I've been trying to chase that feeling ever since. That may be why I chose coaching to be such an integral part of my life. Everything that's happened to you in life has prepared you for what you're doing now. This certainly pertains to not only myself, but my teammates today. A quote that really resonated with me with the 1997 team was a quote from Nolan Ryan. One of the most beautiful things about baseball is that every once in a while, you come into a situation where you want to, where you have to, reach down and prove something. I felt like this 1997 team played to that quote like it was written for us. A historical once-in-a-lifetime team filled with unforgettable memories. These men will be my brothers forever. Thank you for inducting us.
All right, I'm blessed to announce our next baseball team. You know, I've been involved with the CBSLs from probably starting around 1983, so it's been great to have all these guys that have gone through to CBSL, and we've really two main coaches from Coach Schreiner and Coach Mack that's still there. So we're blessed to have great coaching, and our feeder program just keeps moving up and gets them ready. So the next team, the 1999 baseball team, overall record of 28-3, ranked number 8 at the end of the year in New Jersey, number 1 in Union County. They were Union County champs. They were the North Jersey Section 2 Group 3 champions. This time I'd like to call up Coach Mack. Dennis McCaffrey, coach of the 1999 baseball team.
Thank you, Mr. Bruns. First, I'd like to congratulate all the inductees into the Cranford Hall of Fame. It's a wonderful, wonderful honor, and it's great to see so many of you here this evening. You heard Kurt Schreiner speak about changing the program, and he's the one that did it. He really is. He's the one that came to Cranford. He's the one that said, you know, Dennis, we're going to have to do this a different way, and everybody knows Jamie. He did it, okay, and he did it with a way that he was confident what he was going to do and how he did it. He also mentioned a couple people along the way that I have to mention, too, you know, as far as, you know, we talk about a baseball culture here. I was fortunate enough to be able to have people to learn how to coach from, and that's my high school football and baseball coach are here, and they've been along with me every step of the way, and that's Coach Shaw and Coach Wagner. I say thank you very much for everything you've done. Coach Wagner gave me my first football coaching job, my first coaching job at all, and I say thank you. Also, Coach Schreiner mentioned Mr. Finizio. You know, you live in a town where most towns you don't really know who your superintendent is, and I know Coach Schreiner touched on this before, but Mr. Finizio was along every step of the way with us as well, so we say thank you. Also, you heard about the tradition here. Years ago, we heard, you know, in football that we couldn't win here. You have a football coach that's winning year after year, and that's Coach Rosenmeyer. I'd like to give him a round of applause. I'm going to say Coach Rosenmeyer is the most influential coach in Cranford Athletics right now, because he's the one that brought weight training as a phys ed class here. So if you come to any one of our games, our kids are stronger, bigger, and faster than most teams. And that's a credit to Coach Rosenmeyer by making sure that all of our student athletes lift each and every day in gym class instead of playing some ridiculous pickleball, no offense, phys ed teachers, or waste of time basketball where they're not competing, okay? We're talking about Coach Rosenmeyer that makes sure every person, it doesn't matter if they're an athlete or not, all the phys ed people at the high school, they make sure all of our student athletes are lifting. So we say thank you very much as the coaches here to everything you're doing. This year, this team, the 1999 team, was a special team, and they had a blueprint of what to do from the 96 and the 97 and 98 team, you know, how to do it. The unique thing about this team was they won the first county championship. It was mentioned before about, you know, Cranford couldn't win the big one, and that was something that I heard. And something that we brought, Mr. Schreiner and I brought, was every game is big. Okay, and we're not going to go to practice and just have practice. You know, every game is going to be big, and we're going to get after every pitch, every out of every inning. And that 96 team, that 97 team certainly exemplified that. And our 99 team was the first team in Cranford history to be able to win the county tournament. Since then, Cranford baseball has gone on to win 10 more. So they've won 11 altogether. And this 99 team is the first one to set the blueprint. So I'll just mention all the names. I'll just ask you guys to come up here. Jason Collinary, Terry Donovan, Bobby Hebert, Jason Harris. I know Jason's here. Why don't you come up, Jason? Pat Marr, Timmy Meyer, Rob Seeger. I know Timmy Meyer's here. Andy Kindler, Phil Motz, Angel Navarrete, John Polonitza, Rob Sands, Chris Shaw, and Tommy Polito and Jeremy White. We have two All-State, All-Group baseball players on this team. You'll see their jersey, which is hanging up at the field now. You have Timmy Meyer, never lost a high school game. You have Tommy Polito on this team. That's the only pitcher in Union County history to win three consecutive county championships. He's the winning pitcher in the county championship three consecutive years, which is a record I don't think will ever be broken. So this team here, again, they had the blueprint to follow what the 96 and 97 team did, and it's an honor, it's a pleasure to see them. I just asked Pat Marr to come up and say a couple words.
You got a game plan?
I got it. I'm good. Thanks, Coach. On behalf of the 1999 team, I'd like to thank the committee. I also asked you to bear with me. I found out about 2 hours ago I was going to be giving a speech, so jotted it down on my phone. I'll do my best. Also, my daughter, who's 2 years old, woke me up several times before 5 a.m. to have bunny grams and watch Winnie the Pooh, so we'll keep it short and sweet.
That's good.
Congrats to all the inductees tonight, with a special shout out to my 1999 teammates, including inductees Tim Meyer, Coach Jamie Schreiner, and basketball teammate Mike Snyder. I'd also like to echo what Mike said about John Stone, Wheatley, and Bub. You guys were absolutely instrumental in changing the program, as these guys were. I was lucky enough to be on those teams. It just, Mike, you said it perfectly, so I'll leave it at that. But quick shout out to them. Representing the 1999 team, I'm proud to be inducted along with the rest of my teammates to the Cranford Hall of Fame with such a great class of inductees and teams. It's great to see so many familiar faces, teammates, coaches, teachers, and most especially friends. Cranford sports were a big part of my life, and the coaches and teachers were such great role models. I knew and played with some of my teammates over here since I was 8. In fact, Jay Harris and I led the Crows past Rob Seeger, Chris Barron, and the rest of the Mohicans, crushing them 7-6 as 8-year-olds in the Memorial Tournament. I know because I still have the game ball. As we all progressed over the years, we were excited to get started on our high school careers. We were lucky enough to play under great coaches like Terry Hanratty and Scott Birmingham, and having successful years going undefeated. But Cranford baseball program was forever changed when Jamie Schreiner took over the varsity program. The 1997 team, shout out to you guys. Big congrats to them for showing us the way. They were the first team to truly benefit from Jamie's coaching style, and our 1998 team was lucky enough to play under him for a year, one of the best years of my career. As mentioned, I'm pretty sure our team was undefeated as freshmen and sophomores, and then went undefeated for most of the junior season. We then lost the county finals, a state game, and our final regular season game. Someone should fact check me, but I think that may be the reason Jamie handed off the team. Sorry, coach, that we didn't get more championships for you. All jokes aside, Jamie laid the foundation, and Dennis McCaffrey here came in and built the house. That house is like 10 floors and continues to add on each year. Cranford's baseball program is respected as a baseball powerhouse, but also as one built with integrity and character. Our team won the Sportsmanship Team of the Year award, something I was as proud of as our sectional finals win. By the way, I have that game ball too. Thanks, Jamie and Dennis, for showing us what hard work and dedication can lead to and for taking a program to the highest levels. Thanks, Timmy, Rob, Jay, the rest of my teammates, for making our team such a joy to be a part of. We had fun and we did it the right way. Thank you. This has been a great night. Enjoy the rest of it. Thanks.
Congratulations to the 99 team as well. Moving on in the program, I'm going to bring back head football coach Eric Rosemeyer to introduce our next team.
We lost some of the wrestlers. There's a fire engine outside, apparently. There's just flashy lights and they just ran down the street. Some stereotypes are true. As we come to this point in the night, I think to state the obvious is that, and I can say it comfortably in this room, is that there's nothing like winning. Nothing like it. When you talk among the general population, you have to qualify that and say things like, other than the day that I got married, or other than the day that my daughter was born. But when you're among with the people in this room, they understand that that's understood, and there's nothing like winning. And in Cranford, we win at everything. We either just won or are gonna win next year. And that's the truth. And it's been proven as we go back in our history by many of the people in this room. Coach White showed us how to do it in track. Coach Johnstone, we saw it in basketball. Coach Schreiner, Coach McCaffrey, in baseball. Coach Buno in softball. We win at everything. In 2008, it was volleyball's turn. Winning a state championship is one of the greatest feelings in the world, and it's yours forever. When you're the first in your school's history to win it, it's even better. And when your team does something that remains unprecedented even almost 15 years later, well then the Hall of Fame comes calling. That's the case for Cranford's 2008 volleyball team. to give details about her team's accomplishments is their head coach and the state of New Jersey's 2008 Volleyball Coach of the Year, Lucy Diaz.
Good evening, good evening. Congratulations to all. What a night. Wow. What talent. We can truly see what a community like Cranford can produce, and we thank everyone for being a part of everyone's successes. So let's hear it for everybody involved who behind us all the way. We are so thrilled and honored to be here tonight. Thank you to the Hall of Fame Committee for recognizing our 2008 Cougars Crush volleyball team. So deserving, a team whose records after 14 years have yet to be broken. Winning Cranford its first ever volleyball state championship, we are still the only Union County Public School volleyball team to win a Group 2 state title. Finishing the season with a 25-4 record, we went 4-0 in tournament play without dropping a set. And hold as the only CHS volleyball team to hit a top 5 mark in the state. To date, 3 members of the squad, all state, all conference, all county players, Chelsea Hoffler, Megan Barsh, and Caitlin Irwin, still hold CHS career volleyball and season high records. So let's give them a hand. By the way, thank you for hanging in there and being here with us. So tonight we leave here as proud, inspiring individuals, taking with us lasting memories of a lifetime, a very, very, very fun experience as the 2008 New Jersey Group 2 state champions. And now we can say Cranford Hall of Fame honorees. As you know, an amazing coaching staff, like family, completes the story. I can't thank my friends and colleagues, my assistant coaches enough, Christy McDarby Cottrell and Jill Haig James, for their devoted commitment and dedication to our program. You know that we could not have done it without you. Never, ever. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Lucy. I just wanted to say, you know, it was really an amazing time tonight as a Cranford High School alumni and volleyball player myself. And Jill and I played together for Cranford, and it's come around that we were able to be here and coach these wonderful ladies and be a part of the state championship. So we thank you. Thank you, Lucy, for keeping us a part of the program. Other thanks are to our amazing support system of parents, coaches, the teachers, the administration, who paved the way, the confidence that we all had, the motivation, endurance, and respect. Thank you to the families, everyone who rode the incredible journey with us. You helped put Cranford volleyball on the map. Cranford who? Cranford what? All right. Congratulations. This is an amazing accomplishment, very special team, and it's just amazing. It's great that, you know, I was a part of it in 1998 and that I came back and coached with them, and they did it.
Thank you. Actually, volleyball is how Christy and I met. I was a freshman, she was a senior, and so we are still friends to this day. I want to say the 2008 New Jersey Group 2022 volleyball state champions and 2020 Cranford Hall of Fame inductees in attendance tonight, captains, and 2008 New Jersey Volleyball Player of the Year, Chelsea Hoffler. And Renee Dobbs. Senior Tony Ann Murphy.
Thank you so much.
And junior and fellow Ryder Bronc, Megan Barsh. As well as Claire Human, Leela Human, Samantha Lamsis, Jessica Poland, Claudia Zalomtik, Caitlin Irwin, Kristen Rupp, Emma Hansen, Julie DeBella, Alexandria Bizup, and Kim LaFranz. Thank you all. Cheers and happy holidays.
And by the way, I just retired from Cranford, from Hillside Avenue School, for, after 20 years, and what an ending. What an ending to my journey.
It's a good thing that I'm the last person up here, because I can take the rest of the night here, right? Well, you know, you listen to this, and I'm going to speak on the Cranford PAL. You know, if you take everybody in this room, and you heard how many times the PAL was mentioned tonight in all the talks, and you just think about it. I'd just like to see, I have a question. Just, if you would, if you had anything to do with the PAL at any time in your career or in your life, PAL, coaching, players, volunteers, anything, would you please stand up? Stand up. Oh, yeah. It's probably, there's probably more, but they can't get up at this point because it's been so long. Okay, it's an honor for the PAL to be inducted into the Cranford Sports Hall of Fame. I had the pleasure of being the first executive director of the PAL from 1981 to 1997. Let me introduce to you the past and present PAL executive directors who are also with us tonight. Believe it or not, we had 5 executive directors and they're all here. Please come up when I call your name. Bob Collinari from 1997 to 1999. 1977. Mike Dow from 1999 to 2005. Chris Polito from 2005 to 2015. And Matt Nazaro from 2015 to present. These men spent countless hours of their own time outside of their job to ensure that the youth of Cranford were given the opportunity to participate in wholesome athletic and recreational activities that would eventually create a good environment not only for them, but for their families, friends, and most important, the township of Cranford. Again, you heard how many times the PAL was mentioned. I am one that I know that my children, and I have 3 of my children here tonight, 3 out of the 4, and Amanda, Dan, and Kag. Would you stand up for a second? These are my children. Look at how old they are, can you imagine? And they were affected by the fact that I was spending a lot of hours out with the PAL. So thank you for bearing with me. I want to take a moment also to thank a special person who also put his heart and soul into the start of the PAL, Chief Harry Wild, who was unable to attend tonight. He was very instrumental in getting the program going. Last week he was honored for his fantastic work with the police department as Grand Marshal of the 125th anniversary celebration parade. And it's definitely a part of this great honor that has been bestowed upon the PAL. Many thanks to Chief Wild for their commitment he made to this organization. I would like to recognize charter members of the Board of Directors. Robert Gurdon was honorary chairman, chief. Myself, the township committee person, Doug Nordstrom, was president. Detective Bill Thurman, Officer Ronald Coles, Officer Bob Schaefer. Tom Dooley. A lot of people know Tom Dooley is very involved in Cranford sports. Especially baseball. He was vice president and our attorney at the time. Officer Bob Merrill was secretary. Recreation director Frank D'Antonio was the treasurer. Harry Wild, who was a lieutenant at the time. Detective Sergeant Milton Mason, who has left us. Officer Bob Seeger, Officer Jim Sweetdeck, High School Athletic Director Bob Lelly, Township Commissioner Dick Salway, and Sergeant Glenn Owens of the Union County Prosecutor's Office. What a varied, great group of people we had to start this this whole PAL and keep it going. Now, just a few of the things and I'll be done. The purpose of the PAL is to provide wholesome and recreational activities that would ultimately prevent juvenile delinquency. That was my thing. I wanted to see Cranford develop a program that could stop the juvenile delinquency, and it has proven to do so. Programs provided: football, cheerleading, wrestling, traveling boys and girls basketball teams, three-on-three basketball tournaments, high school baseball teams, and national and regional tournaments, boys and girls teams in baseball, softball leagues, weightlifting facility, track and field, flag football, double dutch, golf, volleyball, flag rugby, flag football, fencing, coaching clinics, coaching certifications, mentoring for kids with special needs, special events, Field of Dreams, summer camps, trips to professional, collegiate, athletic, and recreational games and events. Some general facts. The PAL operates on totally on fundraising activities to support children with cancer, Special Olympics, Booster Club, Project Graduation Common Sense for Prevention of Drug and Alcohol Abuse, serviced over 20,000 kids. Approximately 90% of these kids that have been serviced have moved on to play Cranford High School sports. And the PAL has enlisted over 100 volunteers from Cranford every single year. Over 100 volunteers. The Cranford PAL would like to thank all the volunteers, including the many police officers and citizens of Cranford, who have given their time and efforts unselfishly so that the youth of Cranford may succeed in all their future endeavors. It's a proven point. The PAL has succeeded. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Chuck, and congratulations, PAL, and a big thank you to the PAL directors and all the volunteers associated with them. This concludes the award ceremony. I'd like to congratulate our individual honorees inductees tonight, as well as the team members and the teams that were inducted and the PAL. Congratulations to all of you. I'd like to wish you all a safe and happy and safe holiday season. If you're interested in purchasing pictures, we have flyers up here that you could grab, go on the website, and purchase some of the pictures that were taken throughout the night. Once again, have a happy and safe holiday season. Thank you.